Vera, could you also turn on your camera now? Yeah. Hi. So I'm really happy to have you here today. And I would like to give a hello, Hannes. I would like to give a very brief introduction. So Vera is a professor for architecture theory and the director of the Department for Architecture Theory and Philosophy of Technics at the TU Vienna. And the department is called ATTP. Vera studied philosophy and English language and literature in Zurich. And she obtained her PhD in media theory and philosophy from Basel University in 2009. I remember hearing the first time hearing a lecture by Vera in 2010. And it was actually the year when she founded the Laboratory for Applied Virtuality at the Architecture Department at ATH with Ludger Hovestad. And why I remember that so well was because she was really baffling her audience with a completely new approach to architecture theory. It was, maybe some of you are old enough to remember, in 2010, there was actually the end of theory discussed. So there was this kind of old theory where architects were turning their back towards it, that was trying to explain architecture or categorize it. And Vera offered such a surprising, a new approach, where she really brought up a discussion between disciplines. So she let architecture talk to philosophy, mathematics, information technologies, literature, and other disciplines. And so I think probably dialogue is a far too flat term for the refined and surprising structures that she's able to reveal and construct through her writings and numerous publications. But this is only one reason why we invited her to Designing Future Realities and also as a guest reviewer tomorrow to our feedback session. So Designing Future Realities is a cooperation by Werkstätte Wattens and the University of Innsbruck. And it is a design course open to all disciplines, which focuses on this dialogue and discussion between design, art, science, and the broader public. And we are also interested in creating a network between artists, designers, and this broader public. And you all know we are here working in a region where using ski lifts is seen as essential and basic daily needs, right? While schools, museums, and university can be kept closed. So I think we are also here to kind of shape the future cultural reality of the region we're living in. And so this is a one reason. And the other reason why we invited Vera is that it's so remarkable how she fosters new generations of researchers in those diverse disciplines. For example, with her Applied Virtuality book series, published at Birkhäuser, that has really developed as a platform, I would say, for young researchers to present their work. And also in that regard, her work and her activities have been a huge inspiration for DFR. And so we're really happy that we can welcome you here today. And I leave you the stage, Vera.
I was just wondering. Thank you so much, Christina, for this very kind and very generous and actually really an introduction with which I, for once, feel very, very comfortable. It's always difficult to kind of say what it is that I'm doing, because it doesn't really have one place. But I have no idea. We know each other since 11 years now. This is great. And I'm very happy to be invited in this context, also to the Designing Future Realities organization, I guess. And I have prepared a lecture with a few slides, and I will share my screen now. And I would be very happy if you keep questions, or if you're either welcome to post them immediately, or you can put them to the chat. And I think we will have time afterwards for discussing as well. So So I will share my screen now. Good. The title of my talk today is it's a bit difficult to pronounce. It's also a bit, it has many words, but I want to talk about this objects that cast shadows. So the title I chose is On the Multifarious Lives of Umbrageous Objects, a Neo-Baroque Cast of Questions to Unsettle Digital Design Ontologies. We will see in a moment that to unsettle doesn't mean I want to pick a fight or anything like that. No, but I want to lift it up. I want to make it fly. And I have no idea whether I will manage, but this will be a first attempt to do so. I want to start by picking up what, as far as I understand, is the motto of the context of the Designing Future Realities, namely to attend to art and design as drivers for sustainable change. And I have been thinking a lot about how to approach this, this motto, because it is a very big, it's a very big topic, of course. And the one aspect that I have been intrigued most in terms of thinking about it is that this idea of sustainability and recycling really, really profoundly challenges also our understanding of logics and of reasoning, because both of those are figures that are cyclical. Yeah, so in logics, we would say they are self-referential. They kind of feed back into themselves, the cycles. And there are many cycles which coexist. Yeah, like, yeah, it's a transcription of the ecosphere, of course, where there are many, many cycles, like the waters, the winds, the sun, all of them are kind of cyclical processes that are not entirely independent of one another, but that don't fit into a systematic, holistic, or rather perhaps a systematic perspective. So what I wanted to focus on as a start then is more art than design, perhaps in the beginning. Also the two, that's my ambition, will be put into a dialogue or into conversation perhaps. I would like to start with a citation by Pao Zhelang, a poet, the early 20th century, who wrote especially, I mean, a lot of poetry, of course, but also one treatise. And this, I find it interesting because it's a genre of writing that is very important for architecture too. A treatise on poetics. And the title of this treatise was The Meridian. And the meridian, if you can picture it, is like the complement to the equator. Yeah, so the meridian is the line which passes through the north and the south pole, whereas the equator is the line that is in the middle of the earth. So he called his treatise on poetics The Meridian, and he said, I didn't find an English translation, so I will try this live, but I want to give you the original words in German as a background. He said, art, if you remember, is like a puppet, a marionette. It has metric feet, jambisch fünffüßig, this is a poetic meter. And this property of art is well testified by the story of Pygmalion and its creature. So it's testified mythologically to be a being that cannot reproduce itself. Yeah, ein kinderloses Wesen. So art is a being which cannot have kids. It cannot reproduce itself in a cycle of reproduction. And yet, of course, art lives. Yeah. So this is a little bit the point that I would like to have resonate throughout my talk. So art, how can we talk about art, and how can art specifically add something to this question, to this difficult question of the cyclic reasoning, let's say, of sustainability and recycling. Christina rightly said in the beginning, the time when I got, I can't say interested, it was just my age that kind of orchestrated it like that. But the time when I got introduced or active in architecture theory was a time when theory was basically declared dead. It was a time when discourse ontologies and classification of different isms, different structures and buildings to kind of describe and place architecture, but also any other fields, also literature and so on. So theory really had, as Bruno Latour had called it, run out of steam. It somehow felt not very exciting anymore. And what we have witnessed since then is a turn to metaphysics, which for me is very interesting because, of course, it's the core of philosophy. But it's also a discourse which allows us to attend in a novel way to materiality itself. And materiality, I think, is very important today because we might feel that we are living in an electric kind of immaterial sphere and in virtual spaces and so on, but there is a materiality to the digital, and it is the materiality of light in quantum physics. So there is a very specific interest that becomes stronger and stronger for me, which is in something like quantum optics, and how can theory, which literally means, no, theoria means to look at something reflectively, so abstractly, formally, theoria. So how can theory recognize itself in a mirror or in the light of quantum optics? And when we look, for example, at very prominent discourses today, like object-oriented ontology, it is quite evident that this new attention to metaphysics, and metaphysics means in a way a discourse which says it cannot legitimate its first principles. Yeah. So metaphysics is something which starts from something being positioned. So it doesn't, it is in a complicated relation to empirical and pragmatical approaches because of that. So in antiquity, people who were working in metaphysics, they would postulate as a principle, for example, the void. No, everything starts with the void, or they would position as principles one of the elements, water, for example, or fire, or earth, or all of the four elements together. So metaphysics is a discourse which, in a way, challenges this great Enlightenment and modernist idea that all theory needs to legitimate itself. So there is always something speculative about it. And interestingly, this interest in object-oriented ontologies, now as a philosophical, let's say, school of thinking, was in a way almost suggested by technology, by a paradigm in programming that is already quite dated for informatics people. So it's not really the latest paradigm in which people are working, but it triggered in a way a new interest into a combination again or a rethinking between ontology and metaphysics. Now, I'm just going to evoke some of the recent discourses. This is an article by Graham Harman, who is the key figure perhaps for object-oriented ontology. And this one is an article which in a way picks up on that problem, let's say, or also this chance of bypassing or of dealing differently with the question of legitimization by postulating there is something that he calls a vicarious causation. And this, I find it very interesting because vicarious, of course, we know it from bureaucracies, no? Where we have basically orders where every position is empty and can be substituted at liberty almost. Yeah. So we have a kind of an order where the components of these orders are insubstantial. to the order that is at work. So we know it from bureaucracies, but we also know it, of course, from the churches, from the organization of institutions, basically. So what this term now begins to elaborate is to say, well, there is a kind of a principle of causation at work, but we have to think it relative to vicarious orders. And with this term, together with saying that object-oriented ontology or programming is applied metaphysics, there begins to or began to happen, both of these texts are already more than 10 years old. No, actually, this one is a more recent one, but it doesn't matter. So object-oriented ontology has been here for a while. And what began to happen with these two approaches is a certain sense of a closure. Yeah, so here we have, so if metaphysics is what we don't even speculate in anymore, but mainly apply pragmatically, then the whole openness that metaphysics provides is being closed down. And if we then begin to look for a principle of causation, which means also an objective reason within vicarious orders, this closure is even more dramatically made explicit. Another contemporary philosopher who is very sensitive to this would be Quentin Meyersou, with a branch of thinking which he calls speculative materialism. And he has done many things, but recently he became quite well known for a search for what he calls the great outdoors. Yeah, so there is an interest into an outside to such a closure of vicarious orders and also of applied logics, let's say, or applied metaphysics, if you want. So what or how could there be reconceivable something that is not always already captured by these frameworks? And this is also what bothers me a lot, where I'm very invested, let's say, to find ways of maintaining a connection to an outside. It is partly what attracts me so much to Paul Gelland's citation here, which I hope will become clearer throughout the talk. So this was a bit of an introduction and a contextualization of what is going to follow. Yeah. So my talk, again with the title, it is about the multifarious lives of ombrageous objects. So on the one hand, I want to talk about objects not as being these reasoned and rational and clear or sterile things, as opposed to things, yeah, which have a kind of a materiality and a messiness and a reality. I want to speak about how objects cast shadows, and through how they cast shadows, they are not in one place. So multifarious is a word that I've just learned, so maybe that's why I'm a bit obsessed with it. But I like it very much because it, on the one hand, it says things that can be that can show themselves in various ways, but they embody a great variety of appearances. And the great variety is not the same like a multiplicity, because a variety includes a kind of a discreteness, whereas a multiplicity is always in a topological continuous space. And the idea of multifarious lives of objects, basically, yeah, this is at the core. And then this great outside, yeah, I'm not sure if it's a great one, but there is an outside. That will be what I want to talk about. But this outside is inside. It's not just enfolded. It's not just folded in, like in the discourse of the fold and in many of the Baroque discourses. If we think it in relation to mathematics as embodying such an outside, this is what I would like to propose a little bit, then it is not of a continuity. It is much more multifarious and umbrageous than just folded and enveloped and interiorized. What I show you here is a citation by Quatremer de Quincy. It is the great architectural theorists of the Enlightenment, one of them, who wrote something which I find, again, very remarkable, because it kind of anchors or grounds theory. No, it's not about theory communicating and reproducing itself and building schools and informing more and more people, but it's very grounded. The object of all theory, he says, is to teach. And one can only teach what can be proved. One proves only to the reason and understanding. If, therefore, it is required that sentiment, so feeling, aesthetics, should be convinced by reasoning, then sentiment will require an explanation, a proof of every proof. There is, on every subject, a limit to all reasoning, which limit theory is bound to respect, and which it would be imprudent to go beyond. Yeah. So if we take into account sensibility, there is a kind of an, every proof requires another proof, and another proof, and another proof. Yeah, we are in an infinite kind of regress. So there is a limit which all reasoning needs to respect. And at this limit, he says, there commences the unsolvable. Farther we cannot go. It is the mathematical line. It is the region of the imaginary where reason quits us and whither none can follow us. It is also that of Icarus, where the wings of the mind too frequently abandon him. So he directly draws a line in order to preserve an outside. Yeah, this is so fascinating. This line is what he calls the mathematical line. And he says, yes, we go beyond the mathematical line in the imaginary with the wings of the mind. We go beyond, but when we go beyond, nobody can follow us. There is no way how there can be a theory of this beyond which would serve to teach, yeah, which could become the object of education, of a kind of a public and a shared body of knowledge. And I am showing you this citation from the start, the beginning of Enlightenment, in relation to another very remarkable document across which I quite recently came. It's a conversation between D'Alembert and Diderot. They are the editors of the great encyclopedia, the French Encyclopedia of the Enlightenment, where they introduced knowledge in an analogous structure to how our minds are organized. So the encyclopedia was not organized according to cosmical orders as it used to be, or according to everything, all the classes that exist in the world, or according to particular disciplines, but the encyclopedia was organized according to memory, reason, and imagination. And part of why Gadamer de Cancy wrote architecture theory at the same time is because he said the words that can be used in architecture find no place in the encyclopedia because they live out of imagination. They come out of invention. The words that can describe architecture are not of the same kind like the words which can describe reality as it is given. So he wrote, and that's what he became very famous for, a lexicon for architectural terms. And it is with respect to this lexicon, and not an encyclopedia, that he made this ambition that theory is supposed to teach, and there is a limit where we basically always have to invent how we can teach what we have drawn from the beyond. Yeah. So how can we teach what we have found in our creative imaginations beyond the mathematical line, but how can we still teach it so that others can learn it? Now, this might sound a bit mystical on the side of Gadamer de Cancy, but let's see what the great Enlightenment philosophers do, D'Alembert and Diderot. What they have in this text is a conversation where Diderot tries to convince D'Alembert of his materialism. And his materialism is of the kind that he says, perhaps we read the first paragraph. This is D'Alembert saying, I grant it is difficult to accept the existence of a being so contradictory in nature, a being which exists everywhere, and relates to no particular point in space, a being which is without space and yet occupies space, which is quite complete in each part of this space, which differs essentially from nature and yet is united to it, which follows and removes matter while itself remaining motionless, a being of which I have not the slightest conception. Yeah. So you see how they are talking about what previous times were, of course, referring to as the divine or as God. So they begin to speak of something like that, but they want to address it in materialist terms. Diderot is very convinced about such a materialism, and he will convince D'Alembert by saying, for all the different phase changes of matter, there are different beings which make it possible. Yeah, for example, if we have a statue, we can render it into food that sustains life. If the statue is being chiseled and if then some plants interiorize it and metabolize it and transform its substance into something which becomes edible, which becomes eatable. So that is perhaps one of the most drastic examples. You see, they are talking about marble that is made with flesh and flesh with marble. So there is at stake a kind of, today we would say, a magic materialism or something like that. There's no need to go to magic. These are the people who introduced perhaps the most sober hygienically cleared versions of amazing things that we know. So instead of directly going into such a materialism, the architect, Gadremer de Cassis, insisted on saying we need boundaries in order to know what we are doing. No, not in order to say we can't go further, but in order to know where we are. And this is an interesting turn because it relates to a very old understanding of the architect as Daedalus, as somebody who is concerned with working craftfully. Yeah, kunstvoll arbeiten. Daedalus literally means to work on something with art. And what is part of this game is that the objects which are called Daedalus, they are objects which cast shadows, but the shadows which they cast are being cast in the light of ability, we could perhaps say. There is not really a good English term for the German word, das Können. Yeah, and Können, it's more than skills. It's more than something that can entirely be explicated. Das Können has something to do with mastership. It has something to do with an interiorized ability that can only partially be taught, that can only partially be communicated. So what the mathematical line begins to attribute to Daedalus is a particular kind of optics, we could say, the light of Können, within which objects cast shadows. And what I am interested in now is how our question with the cyclicities and the complexity of a climate or of an ecology, so of a whole which is dynamic and multifarious, yeah, not only manifold but also multifarious, how such an understanding of objects could inform ideas in design and in art. What we need for such objects in order to teach them is a vessel that is the interesting idea, which also is very old. Yeah, it's a kind of a vessel, a metaphor. A metaphor literally means a vessel to transport something into a context where it does not belong properly. So a vehicle for bringing something elsewhere. And in the rhetorical and in the poetic discourse, there is a long tradition with which we are unfortunately a bit disconnected, but it's coming back. Now, there are several contemporary people thinking in this direction. Figure of thought, this is what was called a trope. And the figure of speech, this is what was called a schema. Yeah? So in both of those notions, there is the idea of a figure, and the figure has to do with the profile, it has to do with the face, but it also has to do with the surface of a body. Yeah, so a figure has something to do with a sculpture, also with a statue. And if we speak of this metaphorically with regard to such objects that cast shadows, we need to place these objects within a tropical line. Yeah, so not just before a background, like we usually say, no, something appears before a background. No, we need to have it within a tropical line where the sun rises and sets. Otherwise, we wouldn't have this scope in the light of an ability. And that is precisely the idea of a trope. That's why trope is derived, or at least very familiar with the tropical line. Yeah, so there is a kind of an equator principle around the tropical line. And if you diverge from this, so if the angle changes, then shadows begin to appear very lively, which is one of the key principles that has informed thoughts about figures. And what speech now does in relation to such thought, so figures of speech, is it creates, we could call these covering spaces of how in the tropical line a figure appears altered, yeah? So figurative. So a schema has something to do with measuring and describing something unique such that you can use it as a vessel to transport it to something else. So there is a principle of duration or of living on or of translation involved that is different than that of reproduction. This is what I mean to say with the emphasis on these two things. And in order to think like this about metaphors, we have to think of the metaphor itself mathematically. Because if we don't, we can't teach it. Yeah, we can show it, so we can perform it, we can manifest it, we can craft it, we can make an object of it, but we can't theorize it. If we want to theorize it, we have to address such vessels, tropes and schemata, mathematically. So there is a way to conceive, not to work with concepts in mathematics that is not logical, that is not the formal, systematical, analytical way of addressing concepts through numbers and forms and equations, so mathematically. Rather, it is a way to relate and to deal with concepts in terms of coding, poetics, and rhetorics. Where this is coming from, not such vessels, such figures of thought, is something very old, no, we could say. So the beginning of mathematics, I mean, that is one of theoretical geometry. That is one of the things that the philosophers usually battle about a lot, or there are so-called foundation wars in mathematics in the 20th century. They all have to do with the statues of theory that as it comes from geometry. And what I would like to show you now, why I'm so fascinated with this play of lights and shadows and objects, is an approach that is represented or has been introduced in the recent times, that means in the last few decades, by Michel Serre, a French philosopher, who began to say that Thales, to whom it is attributed that he established theoretical geometry, was actually approaching problems in precisely this way. Yeah. So the story that he tells here, so he says, okay, the Greek miracle, the emergence of an abstract form and the line of reasoning that abstracts from the practice and the perception of earlier times. He says it worked with the introduction of the gnomon, which is a sun clock. So the sun clock cast shadows, but the reasoning was mobilized by opening up what is called the space of homeothesis. So the whole story is about saying geometry in this abstract form is a kind of a ruse. Geometry is a ruse. It takes a detour. It is never immediate. It takes a detour. It needs to invent something like scaffolds, abstract scaffolds, in terms of which it can move ideas and thoughts and relate them to things where we are not usually expecting to find them. The vehicle, or let's say the technical device that makes this possible, this is the gnomon. But the gnomon gives us the suggestion of an immediacy. So if the sun clock is not mobilized through theory, then we are not yet in this abstract space that made all of these things possible. And a similar kind of a mobilization of what we are used to thinking in terms of analytical systems. This, I think, is what lies in the air today, and where art and design can play a big role in exploring it. I won't go too much into details, because it gets quite technical quite quickly. But I want to show you the most recent book, which is coming out, I think, these days. If it hasn't, perhaps it is already out in our Applied Virtuality book series. It is a book by Elias Tsafiris, who is a theoretical mathematician and physicist. And he has generalized this approach. I mean, he didn't know about CERN, no? So he invented the same thing in parallel. And I met him because I was so interested in the CERN line. And he was fascinated that there is, from within philosophy, a line which corresponds to what he is exploring. So it's a generalization of this gnomonic approach with the vessels and the metaphoras. He calls it an obstacle embracing art of abstract gnomonics, natural communication. I won't bother you here with the abstract terminology, but what is important is the keywords. So it's about coding. Coding plays a very explicit role. That is something that is very rare in mathematical discourses. Code, like in language studies, language itself has been treated as if it were neutral or transparent for a very, very long time. And the same happens with code in mathematics. Code here becomes center stage. It becomes a very important factor of it. And circulation is the basic movement. Then there is a level of a transcendental, which he introduces, but a transcendental which spans between an exponent and a logarithm. Yeah. So an exponent, if you think about this, it is something raised to its own powers. So to the square of itself. This is an exponentiation. And the logarithm, this is a base. This is like the binary code is a logarithm. Yeah, or the decimal system is a logarithm. And between the two, he says, there unfolds the whole world of mathematics. And we can only address the two through a kind of a transcendental reasoning. And this transcendental reasoning, what it does now is to conserve time. Yeah, so it's a kind of a materialist history, which is introduced here. So that's enough of the precise talk. I would like to try to speak about what is at stake here by going to a discourse which is older and with which it is perhaps easier to speak metaphorically about it, but also precisely. It is a book by Giordano Bruno from the 16th century. The book is entitled On the Composition of Images, Signs, and Ideas. And what he tried to do is something very, very remarkable. He tried to invent an ars memoria, so an art of remembering, which interiorizes forgetting. Yeah. And this is very surprising, because usually, no, the limits of memory palaces are, of course, that we can store perhaps as much as we are capable of, but always only reduced to the things which we know that we know. So the things which we actively hold or have held at one point in our minds. So there can be no forgetting with the memory palaces. And what Giordano Bruno set out to do is to think of an art of remembering which feeds from learning to forget. And this forgetting is a kind of an interiorization of the experiences and the events which can be placed. So the placing is something which helps us to forget, not just to make room, not to focus our attention to other things, but it's a kind of an interiorization which has much more to do with the interiorization, which we know from learning to drive a bike, for example. No, in the beginning, this is so tricky. And once we have it, if we would try to keep actively, to picture actively what it is that we are doing while we are riding a bike, we wouldn't be able to do it. Yeah. So it's a kind of an interiorization, which is both bodily, but also intellectual. And it's in this sense that he was then saying, it's not that we represent ideas in images, and then we use signs in order to talk about the correspondence. But there is a level of composition involved with respect to images, as well as to signs, as well as to ideas. Yeah? So he makes an artificial theoretical space to conserve all three of them, and then explore how in these covering spaces they can relate to each other in different ways. Now, Giordano Bruno counts as an occultist philosopher today, and he is becoming quite chic. There are many people now working again on Giordano Bruno. What I mean to say is that I don't find any reason why we should call him an occultist. If occultism means an interest in opening up alternative societies, secret societies, in going against science, in going in secret ways, or even in preserving, you know, in the secret knowledge among a certain circle against another. No, what Bruno was doing had a lot to do with this understanding of theory and teaching, and also of mathematics. So he was completely idiosyncratic in the sense that he introduced techniques from all the different religions, from the Vedic background, as much as from the Hebrew background, as much as from the Greek myth, as much as from the Roman myth, from all discourses. And he always let them play together in this basic idea. And something similar is at stake with this abstract mnemonics. Yeah? So this abstract mnemonics is a discourse which is a lot related to rhetorics, more than to epistemology. So it does not claim to have a direct relation to reveal the truth. But it provides the techniques to treat of things which one can hold to be true, or good, or beautiful, or important, or whatever one wants. So part of what these umbrageous objects and their multifarious lives that I put in the title of my talk, part of what they of course refer to is very nicely describable through still lives. What we have here is a still life from the 17th century, and I would like to contrast it, or to put it in relation with vanity still lives. For example, this one here. If we think in terms of such an understanding of theory, no, that tries to teach, so we can say, okay, here, what we have conserved is all the knowledge, the technical skills of how to diffract light. So this is about colors, colorfulness. So the diffraction of light and the optics at that time. What we have here is about, I would say, is about the constitution of a space. So it is a movement of a triangulation within which the play of the shadows and the colors can be such modulated that these apples appear enormously fleshy and fresh. Yeah, this is abstract, sophisticated, geometrical reasoning at work in such a painted liveliness. What we have here is the process of growth with the nuts as well. So it's a kind of a natural growth, we could say. We have decay, of course. We have vulnerability and the ephemeral. And we have cutting, we have analytics. So this is, if you want, I mean, there is no need to see it or to read it like that, but we can read this still life as if many different scales or scalarities of how to keep things present are placed next to each other on the table. Yeah. So it's a still life. It's life in a still that appears as if it were a representation of a site, but actually it is much more like a memory palace. Yeah, so there is knowledge, there is skill, there is ability, there is können encapsulated in all these different parts. When we now contrast this to Vanita's still lives, for example, this one. Yeah, so here we can say death is part of the scene. Yeah, so it's not really celebrated versus life. Life is celebrated as much, but death and life, they are both here. They're both an essential part of it. And here there comes to be a moralization. So here there is an idea. The title is called Vanitas. So it means the objects which are placed here. They are called instruments which are idle and which are ephemeral. Yeah. So musical instruments, notation schemes, also objects. So things that can be crafted with skills that we can say are presented naturally here, they start to be moralized. But that means also totalized. Yeah. This becomes more drastic in this still life here. So here it's called das große Vanitas-Stillleben. And what we see here is that vulnerability, power, is being symbolized in the symbols of the vicarious orders. Yeah. So we have everything that is powerful placed on this site in order to drastically present an engagement with death, let's say, and the power that goes with it. What I find interesting in this contrast is that here we can say, this is now a description I take from Ludger Hofestadt. So he describes with respect to coding, geometry, he speaks of the eyes of time as well as the eyes of space. And what he says is so fascinating in coding is that we don't need to choose one of them over the other. Rather, they can play together, like life and death are playing together here. So the eyes of time, they go in a line. Yeah, they go in a line. So it's basically, this is chronology. It's chronos. So they go in a line. This is the eyes of time. But if we look at time with the eyes of space, we encircle a certain moment, a certain duration, a certain event. We encircle it and then we can triangulate it. So we can constitute a space for the same time that we can only follow in a line with the eyes of time. And this is interesting because it gives us an approach to think of space as being abducted from time. So not time as a fourth dimension or time as something independent of space, but both of them as being in a kind of a recycling, we could say, in a generative, at least a cyclical and generative kind of movement. And one way to make sense of these symbolizations, which we have here and also in the other one, is that there is a competition between the line and the circle. Yeah, and the two are being short-circuited. And then this kind of artistic skills becomes unholy, yeah? becomes vain, a vanity. So we want to hold on to this, to keep the two sets of eyes, which we both need to rethink theory, apart from each other. And think about then, where could we find such a notion of space? Space that is abducted from time in such a way. And here again, I would like to point you to a book by Michel Serre. It is called The Incandescent. Incandescent is something which is not quite lighted. So it's not, it has the capacity to lighten up. Yeah, it's neither, incandescent. So es kann entflammbar. So it can flame, it can catch fire, but it is not burning. And it's a book about memory and forgetfulness, about nature and culture, about a notion of the universal, and how we can speak of the universal in the terms of what he calls the chronopedia. The chronopedia is you can think of it, knowledge that is placed in things. And knowledge that is placed in things is now not artificial versus natural, but rather nature itself, in the genetic code, places its own memory in all of its things. So the underlying story of this book is the DNA code, which everything shares, no, to more or less degrees, but to very, very high degrees. So there is a kind of an objective memory in the DNA where the material traces of the earliest moments are purported and kept conserved, probably till the end of the time. So that's a material notion of history, which is very remarkable, and of which I don't know anybody else who has written about it. And how he speaks now is very concrete. So he begins with a scene in the mountains, perhaps Innsbruck, not sure. It's in the mountains. There is a river, there is a plain, there is a house, there is a family living in this house. And what he now begins to describe is how every object in that scene is caught up in cycles of duration that depend upon each other. So he says this is the site of what he calls an ecstatic epiphany. It is the space where time is swallowed up, where time is being suspended. So this is the image, yeah, of having the eyes of time and the eyes of space playing together. And what he describes now is that there is something like, he calls them balconies of space-time. And such a balcony of space-time is, he describes the world of the little girl. No, he is empathic with the little girl, but she goes for adventures, but she explores before the background of security, which is her father. Then he describes the world of her father, what he explores, what he does, how he builds the house, how he does agriculture, which is supported by the house which his parents had built. Then he goes, he describes the scale of the house which was built by this person's parents. And he describes how all the elements of this house had been assembled from the woods, had been collected from the grounds, had been fit together in order to stand there, protected or before the background of skills that people have brought with them when they came there, and so on and so on and so on. He goes until the stones which have come from the glaciers, which have come moved by the water, which was from the ocean and through the winds brought the current to this river. So he describes all of these cycles and shows how they support one another, but also interfere with one another and act like balconies of space-time. So the key focus here becomes to be landscape, but not as landscape in distinction to cities, but landscape as something like la visage de la terre, so the face of the earth. A kind of it's a face, or it's a figuration of the earth itself. He describes then how these different scales can interact. So the rose and the gardener, different durations, lifespans, compositions between the two. And it is perhaps, if some of you are familiar with Deleuze and Guattari, it sounds quite similar to what they call between the wasp and the orchid, for example, this kind of machine making. But it is essentially different because with the machine making, there is always a continuity. There's always a topological continuity that interlinks the two. Whereas in all of these scales, there is a certain autonomy to all of these scales. So they're not locked in into a machinic system. They're dynamisms which are nomadic, something like this. And of the same thinking, he developed also quite a political book, which he called Times of Crisis. And what he discusses here, this book came out in the year of the great financial crisis. And what he discusses is that this crisis, even if they manifest as something like a financial crisis, we need to think of them like earthquakes. Because earthquakes are sudden events that result from many, many, many tensions and breaks and constellations that go back very deep in time and that don't have one cause. Yeah. So what he then proposes is that we need to say time itself is always a time of crisis, because when an event happens, we are attentive to it because there is an intervention to what we have expected. So we pay notice of time when something unexpected happens, and this is the nature of it. So it's not about saying today we live in a time of crisis, whereas earlier there was continuity. It wants to break with this kind of narrative of history, which directly relates to such an understanding of space. Yeah, space as being abducted from time. What this puts to the foreground a lot is the weather. So it's literally the sphere that is not properly the earth nor the sky. They have called this sphere the meteora, so that which spans between heaven and earth. And in a better term, it is that which is kept in suspension. So meteorology relates to it, of course, but also a meteor or a meteorite. If you think about what a meteor is, no, it's an object which comes from another galaxy. So it carries a completely different kind of time in its embodiment that it brings. But then it also, people who wrote about the meteora in not in current times, but in older times, until Descartes, almost every philosopher wrote a treatise on meteora. The phenomena that he treated were stars, winds, rain, snow, hail, rainbows, lightning, but also earthquakes. And there are interesting analogies of this now to a new kind of a materialism that relates to this electric or this quantum optics. But we can't explore this much here. What I want to say is that with regard to this meteora, we are in a kind of a reasoning which is circling. And there is an old tradition, specifically in architecture. I can just give you the index. I'm not going to speak about this text, but it's a very interesting one by Richard Patterson, what Vitruvius said. What I extracted from it here is this attention to the tropic. So the tropic is the shadow from which all realistic discourses try to flee. Yeah. So this is an interesting statement, because what he argues is that architecture, theory in architecture specifically, was from the beginning a discourse which precisely does not want to flee from the shadow, but affirms the tropicality that comes with it. And this, he says, is specific to the way in which Vitruvius was speaking of ratiocination. So a kind of a reason of a rationality that does not seek to become pure, yeah, sterile, pure, ideal, but that lives in a material sense. And it's for this reason that he says architecture theory, as it has been introduced with Vitruvius, was a theory of technology, avant la lettre, because there was no notion of a logos of techniques at that time. But he says there is a way to read architecture theory in precisely these terms. If it embraces its relation to rhetorics, to figure, to trope, and so on. So, and this is indeed a fact that the categories with which Vitruvius began to speak about buildings were translated and also transported from rhetorics. So how to devise a good speech, no? This is where disposition is coming from, where symmetry is coming from, where eurythmy is coming from. These terms, they have been long established in rhetorics, and Vitruvius kind of made an analogy step and said, well, we should perhaps start to speak about how to build a good building in the same way like the rhetoricians speak about how to compose a good speech. And good here is free of the morals. Yeah, that's important. That's why he calls it a discourse on technology. I cut this a bit short and want to point you to recent contributions that go in an interesting direction, which resonates with this. One is Lars Buybrock, who began to basically take a quantum optics view and said, today we need to start speaking about a visibility of radiance. Yeah. A visibility of radiance. So radiance or the presence of light triggers a different play of appearances. He develops a whole theory of what he calls the phenomenotechnics. For an architecture of figuration. That is his recent his recent book with the title Grace and Gravity, which is a title which he took with this. Also, it's about light. It's about the materiality of light and how to rethink the object in its terms. And he was inspired by a book by Simone Weil. So he inverted her title. She wrote the book in the 30s, I think, or early 40s, which was entitled Gravity and Grace. And what she began to say here is that there are two forces that rule the universe, light and gravity. Yeah. So gravity brings everything down, light lifts things up. And what she was interested in is to give a natural philosophy, basically, of this effect of light and loftiness that would play on the same level like the natural philosophy that plays on gravity. And the way that she thought of this is to say, our intellects, they feed on light, like our bodies feed on water and bread and meat and so on. Our intellects literally feed off light, a bit like photovoltaics. Yeah, she was speaking of chlorophyll here, conferring. So feeding on light, so a kind of a metabolism that plays with this double character of light as being on the one hand the Stofflichkeit and on the other hand the material, no, the icon of intellect and so on. So to kind of go or interiorize the trespassing of the mathematical line, we could say. And Lars Buybrock relates to this, but what he's really interested in is to speak in terms of a new optics of this quality of light. And I think we should stop soon, huh? So I cut short my presentation. With this, perhaps, because these ideas to relate Dioptra, light, meteora, and the discourse on the world is not something that is being invented now. There is a long tradition to it. The picture that you see here is from René Descartes, who wrote a treatise on the world. No, actually, it is a book on the world. That's what it came to be entitled. But he wrote it as a treatise on light. And it's one of the pictures in relation to it, which puts to the foreground that perhaps the world should not be modeled in terms of a system where we can duplicate it, but through such covering spaces that can be moved around to explore and describe objects in how they cast shadows. I think with this, there's a good point to stop. And to come back to the first citation, no, what is art? If art cannot have children, art cannot reproduce itself, as we know this from production lines. Good, this was my title. I hope I was able to live up to some of the promises that the title makes, and I look very much forward to going to discussions now.
Thank you very much, Vera. This, as always, there's also another reason why we invited you, because now we have again the reading list. And there were so many interesting topics that were raised that really, I guess, the audience has many questions in mind and hopefully comes forward with them in the chat room. And maybe I would like to ask you first. I mean, I found it so interesting that you said, or that you quoted, that art is this childless creature. And then, you know, even to be childless today is even something that's really moralized a lot, right? So, you know, this whole sustainability discussion, of course, is. And the cyclic always says that there mustn't be a loss, right? And then we all know, and on the other hand, what the sustainability asks us is also to give a sacrifice, which is a loss on the other hand. So it's also this idea of the sustainability is not even a consistent story, right? I find, because what is it? It's a loss if I can't drive a car anymore because I lose my freedom. But then you mentioned this potential of the artist and that there could be a new role or importance, maybe. Did I understand it right? And how is that related to the metaphor? Are you suggesting that we should again make use of these metaphors, or, you know, what let's say, put it in other words, maybe even simpler, what artists would you mention in this regard where you see this potential happening?
You mean which artist?
Yeah, I mean, I had in mind, you know, Olafur Eliasson in his early work, where he was pouring color into the river and turned the river green. But on the other hand, I don't know if that is that, it's not that multi-scalar that you were talking about, right? Yeah. You were talking about something much more refined, I understood.
Yeah, no, I think our big problem today is that we kind of think that art is the other to science. No? Mm-hmm. So this is something which came, that's why I was talking about these early times of the Enlightenment. So it is something that came at that time. So before that, there were the liberal arts, and it was clear that they all built upon each other, and they are kind of abilities, they're generic skills, they're not disciplines or fields or something like that. And what happened with the around the time of the Enlightenment is a separation of the liberal art schools into fine art and mechanical art, so into the polytechnical schools and then the bildende Kunst. And this separation, I think, from today's point of view, is extremely, extremely hindering and not really relevant anymore at all. But what it then means is that this mathematical thinking should, of course, become a self-evident part of an artist's work. Yeah, so it's no longer just about showing people and creating awareness and so on. No, it's about acting with responsibility, no, exploring things that have not yet been brought. That's why I like this idea of the mathematical line, no? Because you have to demonstrate first that there is something, because people can't follow. So you have to bring it back and to give it some kind of an appearance, a body, where many people can start to puzzle about it, and then through that to domesticate it and so on. Mm-hmm. So I would say, I don't know whom I should name as an artist. It's really it's a kind of an interest in taking art more serious again, I would say, no? Because it in my perception, art has become very entertaining as well, and very, very much instrumental for certain social agendas and certain pedagogical programs, let's say. And I don't think this is the potential of it. Yeah. And I think what on the other hand, in this interplay between design and art, what is very interesting is that in design, very often much more of such polymath skills are there. Mm-hmm. But somehow a great interest to be very pragmatic also at the same time. So there could be, so now, like when we say this meteora, it's between heaven and earth. We could say this meteora that would be between design and art. Yeah. So kind of to populate this such a zone. And it's not quite an interface, yeah, because an interface wants to be functional. So it really wants to work. The point with the meteora is that one has to take care. No, if you go hiking in the mountains, it's dangerous. So the weather embodies a danger, which is not just a question of administration that some social body do or don't do, but it's a kind of an outside which is always present and with which we need to become more aware. No, that's again a wrong formulation, but be friends with it. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it's interesting because I was thinking when you also talked about the book by Michel Serre on the crisis, right? And we are in crisis, and the art scene is shut down at the moment in a way, but we also don't hear at the moment voices from art or from, I mean, architecture is anyhow a too slow process sometimes, I have the feeling, but art should be quicker in a way. And I'm curious, when hearing that talk today, I had in my mind, you know, what will happen after that shock when we get back? What art will appear, or what kind of different art practices? So we'll see. Are there any further questions by the audience? Or by my colleagues? I see that there are also many people from these other disciplines. We have people from physics and technology, of course. So I'm wondering what you are coming up with questions. Okay. Yes, Simon, please. Simon, you can just turn on your camera and microphone.
Hi.
Hi.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, yes. I can hear you.
Hey, thank you for your nice talk. I'm coming from the physics side, actually. Mm-hmm. So it was really interesting to hear also about light and matter, materialism, and all these things. And I wondered if I understood right that you think like that quantum optics breaks the circle of self-reference somehow. What do you think by this? Because I thought like, and because you mentioned also like this warping up of events, right? Temporal events in a circle to make it to connect to space. So the connection between time and space. And they wondered if you use quantum events, if this kind of breaks this picture, if this is what you meant by the problem of self-reference.
Yeah, well, I mean, the problem of self-reference in is an old one in logics, no? So then there have been many approaches to let go of the principle of the excluded middle and so on. So there are, of course, approaches to this, but they remain immaterial, so they're logical. And what I'm interested in with quantum physics is a kind of a transformation of on the level of substance that is at stake. So if I'm not mistaken, what quantum mechanics basically measures is action directly. Yeah. So it's action, which then can only be traced in a twofold way. So either location or extension. So, but it's an action. So that means the object which is being measured is absent. No, there's only a kind of a trace which is being captured in a double way. And but I don't mean to. So I don't think that we gain a lot if we try to describe in an object in a design world or in a world of artifacts now the things on such a technical, precise level as people in physics are describing it. But there is, we are teaching, this Elias Tsafiris, with whom we are working, is teaching a course for our students in mathematical thinking. And last year, he gave them as an exam question something that I found extremely striking. So he took the plague that Carl Sagan and his colleague sent into space when they tried to communicate the knowledge of humans to aliens. Yeah. So this is not science fiction, this is science. Yeah. So they were thinking a lot, how could humanity get in touch, get in communication, if there is alien life anywhere else? And what one of the aspects, and that's what he asked the students about, that he communicated was a scheme like the Vitruvian Man. Yeah? So how to measure human proportions, but relative to the water molecule and the spin in its charges, which this provided a unit to which one can establish a relation like Thales did to the pyramid. Mm. It has nothing to do with describing the size of a human or the size of a pyramid, but with giving a measure to get into communication. And this is possible because of the weight of atoms. No, it's like our time. So the real time is measured in terms of the velocity of light speed, which comes from the weight of atoms in relation to the Big Bang. So there is a materiality supporting the way that we are measuring things, but we don't think in these terms. So that's what I'm interested in, more than now describing in terms of quantum physics what makes me like this pen so much and not another or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, no, okay. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Simon. Hannes Erler also has a question.
Yes, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, hello.
Very good. Thank you very much that I tried to forget everything what you told us, but it did not work. It was fantastic, this book from the 17th century. So my question would go in the direction you spoke a little about these metaphors and let's say these figures of thought and the figures of speech. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to ask you, because when we as students in the DRF course, we built some Mozilla Hubs rooms where we have been in mixed reality and let's say in virtual reality rooms, which worked very well for the brain. But then in the work I saw, we have to come back to reality. So I did a little work on the expression of fetish. So I wanted to ask, fetish are some things that bring us to somewhere. In most of the cases, they have been used as religious symbols in different cultures. And you spoke about that metaphors are vehicles to bring us something elsewhere. So I thought in architecture, how do you see this role of fetish? How do you see them in relation to let's say to trope and schema? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a very good question. I mean, in a way, it's almost as if today, I mean, this is a very provocative thing to say, but there is something to it, to say that today we don't have images anymore, no? In an old sense. The images are gone. So because we bring into appearance, we render present whatever we want, however we want. So images are not there. So then I would say insisting on there being an autonomy or a kind of a resistance through images, this is fetishism. Yeah. So that would be my point. Whereas to affirm figures of thoughts and figures of speech as what they are, namely figurations or renderings, uh-huh, doesn't quite go as far as to make something that is fascinating into a fetish. So there's a kind of a soberness now attached to this poetic or figurative dimension, let's say, as opposed to the insistence on a kind of an autonomy of images today. Mm-hmm.
And it would mean that fetishism is something that is very rigid and does not allow for interpretation. And I thought sometimes it could be good because if you are lost in somehow different worlds or pictures or problems, then it's good to come back with something. So in my rooms, I had the intention to print something that you take with you. So you are in a virtual room and virtual world for quite a long time with different people, but then you print something that is real. And this is a symbol that can help you always to come back to the situation.
Yeah.
So it's a helper like that, yeah. So, but another observation that I made when you said these beautiful things, I do not know who said it, but it's about like that. If somebody in the world would come and would understand the secrets of how the universe is building the future, the universe would immediately destroy itself and would replace it by a much more complicated or complex universe. And that brings me to somehow there are secrets and we should be happy with that secrets that we cannot understand.
Yes, but this I would absolutely say so as well. So there is a beautiful kind of, I call it almost a cornucopia. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So if we radically affirm that everything of which we feel we know it, so knowledge, appears mm-hmm. before the background of its negative, of non-knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
So the more knowledge we have, the vaster the space of non-knowledge, the cosmic ocean, we could say, of the universe, about which we don't know. Uh-huh. So what I don't believe is that we need to take care that the secret remains preserved. Huh? So that was my point against the occultism was this. I don't think this is in our responsibility, precisely not. Yeah. Uh-huh. So it's just like we can't. So we can't. It's like we can't know what we don't know.
Yeah.
So if we try to take care that we don't forget anything, we create mm-hmm. this closure of which I was speaking in the beginning.
Yeah.
It's a totalizing move. It's a totality which works off, which excludes and gets very rigid. But I wouldn't bring this so quickly in a direction with fetish. Maybe I couldn't quite follow. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Vera, I would also have almost a practical question. If you're saying that the artist or the designer should also learn to think in mathematical terms, let's say. Mm-hmm. Speaking also from a research project where we are currently working with mathematicians, we found out that we just simply don't have the same language or even terms, or that we even have these monopoles of terms. So there was a funny episode where the mathematician told us, don't use the word feature because you don't use it in the right way because it wouldn't be understood. And then we said, well, then you don't use the word architecture because that's our word. But looking at your research group, right, and your corporations, how do you tackle that? How do you, you know, and even thinking about how you also make these terms productive so that they start to become even, okay, gain even more meaning? How does that practically work?
Yeah, I would hope so. So it were, I mean, that's why we put this emphasis on code. Yeah. So we don't think in terms of fields of disciplines which are proprietarily administrated. So if I don't understand what Elias is telling me, he needs to code it in a way that I can learn to understand. Then I code it back. We project until we feel we have an understanding. So it's not about, so the that's the other thing. So on the one hand, the bildenden Künste, so die schönen Künste und die technischen Künste, this is a catastrophe that this happened like it did today. Perhaps it was a good thing 200 years ago, yeah. So I'm not saying that, but to insist on that today, I feel is a catastrophe. And the other thing is to say that a language which can be public needs to be a formal language. It needs to be a technical language that is entirely formally clarified. So, because this means it's no longer a language, yeah? It's a code. It becomes a code which is being protected by a certain community that takes the responsibility for it. But there is a different sense in which within vernaculars, I'm a much greater fan of vernaculars, because in vernaculars, it's a bit like with knowledge before the background of non-knowledge. When we speak in vernaculars, we also want the people with whom we talk to understand what we mean. But we know that it's not a question of knowing a word or not knowing it. Yeah. So we invent how to communicate it. So it's alive, it's an active thing in which something is at stake. It's not just a question of me being not abstract enough or the other person not knowing the terms that they would need to know. So we both need to care. If we want to make this work, we both need to care. And the level of code gives an objectivity to this. So that is, for example, why in our collaborations, we work with Mathematica. So with this Wolfram environment, where you can really, also without knowing sophisticated coding, you can try to, okay, but when Elias speaks of this natural logarithm, so I can call it to the stage and I can try out things and I get a feeling for it. I don't need to learn analytically to do mathematics in order to somehow build an idea, eine Vorstellung, how he means this interplay between logarithm and exponent. And then when I get an idea of it, my ambition is never to speak mathematics. I'm not talking with mathematicians about these ideas, but it helps me to talk when I'm interested in scale, for example. It helped me to grasp why I had this intuition with Michel Serre on the Meteora for a long time that we need to separate scale from dimensions. So scale is not a synonym for dimensions. So, but how to think this? And precisely the distinction between logarithm and exponent helped me to articulate it. Yeah. So there is a precision, but the precision relies within the things themselves, not within the languages that are administrating our discourse on it. And this demands a lot of trust and familiarity as well, of course. So it's not easy, but it works.
Thank you. Yeah, I think we are already over time, right? I think if there are no other questions, then I would once again like to thank Vera a lot for that really inspiring talk. And I'm really happy that we can continue this conversation tomorrow with the students in the sessions. And so thank you very much. So everyone is allowed to use icons now or turn on cameras and clap. And we also, Barbara wants me to mention that we have another talk on the 15th of March by Thomas Feichner. Yeah, some more applause.
Nice to see you. Thanks.
We hope we can invite you next year again in presence. So let's try that. And then also Barbara is posting that in the chat, that there is this feedback form that she put together, where VFR is trying to get a better understanding how this format works and how it can be improved. So please also do that if you have time. And yeah. Thanks to all of you. Thanks to the crowd. Some of you are now really constant visitors, and it's almost as if we would know you already. So, and thank you once again, Vera. Yeah.
Thanks to all of you. And see you tomorrow. Bye.
Bye. Bye.